In 1977, producer-director George Lucas created the Star Wars trilogy and changed the way we looked at movies. Now, 20 years later, using new digital technology, Lucas and his creative teams at Lucasfilm, THX, Skywalker Sound, and Industrial Light and Magic have completely restored, enhanced, and added to these classic movies to create the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition.
The original inspiration for bringing the film out again was the fact that it was the 20th anniversary of the original release of the film.
I want to learn the ways of the Force and become a Jedi like my father.
I had an ulterior motive that I'd been thinking about for a long time, actually ever since the films were finished, which is there were various things, especially in the original film, that I wasn't satisfied with. Special effects shots that never really were finished, scenes that hadn't, you know, that I'd wanted to include that couldn't have been included for some reason, mostly money and time. And I really wanted to fix the film and have it be completed. The most obvious thing that's happened is we've gone back to the original negative, cleaned it up considerably, redone a lot of the optical effects, the wipes, the dissolves, and improved the quality of the film because it was deteriorating. And I think this one had deteriorated a lot more than anybody expected in 20 years. So you're getting to see a brand new print that's very clean and is actually better than the original release.
The actual original negative, it was so far gone that unless we actually did this at this time, we were never going to have the film to be able to release ever again.
I got him! Great kid! Don't get cocky!
I definitely did the movie on the seat of my pants. I didn't really know what I was doing. I mean, I had some experience in animation. I knew how to make movies. And, you know, I knew that I was going to attempt to do something that had never been done before.
To try and do a multi-generational modern-day myth had not been done as far as I knew.
I brought you here. Now what?
We have to find the rebels. What we're carrying belongs to them.
The script was unlike any I'd ever seen before.
He had borrowed from Wizard of Oz or Kurosawa films, or, you know, he's just steeped in film lore. So it just sort of went through his pores, and that's how he imagines things. George has an extraordinarily visual imagination.
The first one was done under extreme conditions. It was very low budget, and it was very challenging to get it done in the amount of time, considering we had to invent a lot of new technologies and do all kinds of things that had never been done before.
We didn't even know if we could do the job and get it done in the time that we had to do it. We didn't know if we could make it look real or not, if it was going to look like most of the other science fiction films that had been done that looked pretty fake. So it was a problem of trying to come up with a look that could allow George's vision to get on the screen and be executed for the amount of money and for the time that we had.
One of the things that impressed me on all the movies was the way George could take scotch tape and popsicle sticks and really make something out of it. When I went, I had visions of what it would look like to see the Death Star blow up. And they had the equivalent of, say, six ping pong tables in the parking lot somewhere in the valley with all the tchotchkes glued to the surface, all these model kits. I mean, they cannibalized thousands of battleship kits and just glued them all on, and they were making passes on it with, you know, somebody just driving a Jeep. And of course that's the footage of the TIE fighters flying past the surface.
The essence of the storytelling had to be sacrificed for the limits of technology. George had very specific shots that he wanted to be able to achieve, but it was extremely difficult to do that with models on wires. So although for us in 1977, when we first saw it, it was still powerful, it was still big, he never got visually the dynamic shots that he actually wanted to get. So we've redone those.
I've taken a lot of the special effects shots that weren't really as good as I'd hoped they would be, because they were sort of prototype technology, and I've been able to improve them and just add that little difference, and I've done it with a lot of the in battle shots.
You know, you can actually see them. They come straight over camera, they go underneath camera, we can pan with them, you can see the pilots inside of them, you can see their heads moving. That was a real challenge, but a really, really a great deal of fun to do.
Great shot, kid, that was one in a million.
Mos Eisley was one of the scenes that actually prompted this whole adventure of redoing the movie. Because there were some scenes in there with the speeder that was obviously supposed to float across the landscape. And in the Mos Eisley sequence coming up to the cantina, they never really accomplished that. And all the best they could do was to put some Vaseline on the lens to kind of fudge out the wheels under the car. But it didn't look like it was floating. It was sitting right on the ground. And there was this sort of orange blob underneath it that was, we jokingly called the force field. That combined with the fact that I wanted to have Mos Eisley to be more exotic and to be larger and to have spaceships and more creatures running around and more like a real city is what really prompted a lot of this redo on the film. So we designed a series of shots which show Mos Eisley in a much grander scale. We pull back and see the whole city. We see a lot more beasts of burden moving around in the city, activity, and it just gives you a better sense of what Mos Eisley is.
One of the things we were concerned with right from the beginning was we certainly didn't want it to suddenly look like a brand new, different looking shot every time we dropped in one of the redos or improved or new shots. So a broad category of the new work we've done is to take the original elements that were used to comprise the shots and recombine them now using mostly computer technology.
When you're creating a world, part of what you do is whimsy and part of what you do is for plot movement and part you do just for your own personal interest and psychological eccentricities. I think Dubak's were put there out of whimsy. I wanted to give a kind of random real world feel to everything. So I wanted to do some things that weren't predictable, like having stormtroopers ride on Dubaks. In the original movie, in order to get Dubaks and things into the movie, we built a large rubber mannequin, really, that we were able to move around from set to set. He had a big stick in his head that somebody could sit alongside and move the head back and forth, and that was about as much movement as I could get out of it. And I always wanted them to have movement and walk around and be part of the population of the film. I added the Jabba the Hutt scene with Han Solo, which was a scene that had been cut out due to time and money constraints. And once I finished the third film, I really wanted to go back and put that back in there because it was sort of relevant to what happens to Han Solo at the end of the movie. And I really wanted to be able to connect the first film with the third film the way it was meant to be.
Right here, Jabba.
Been waiting for you.
The scene was originally shot with an actor playing Jabba the Hutt to stand in for whatever creature we designed. Originally, I thought Jabba the Hutt would be kind of a furry character like Chewbacca. But as we went on and I redesigned him for Return of the Jedi, he obviously became a large slug and a very different kind of character. So we had to figure out a way of fitting that design into the original scene.
The ultimate goal is to make it look like Jabba was on the set talking to Harrison Ford, and we just photographed it. The plan was for us to remove this actor and replace him with Jabba. He had to be physically in that space where this actor was.
This project here was about 5 shots, took about a year to do. We took the picture of some of the stuff we found. We used some of the off-the-shelf software to build a 3-dimensional wireframe mesh. Then the next process is actually paint the creature. And with the painting of the creature, it also involves the actual texture of the surface of the characters.
We got to a certain point where everything was set, but there was one problem. Han Solo walks around Jabba.
We had to somehow shift Han. It would have been literally impossible for him to walk behind the Jabba character because of the tail. So George had the idea, so why don't you have him step on his tail?
Even I get boarded sometimes.
You think I had... At some point, a famous filmmaker said, films are never completed, they're only abandoned. And rather than living with my abandoned movie, I really wanted to go back and complete it.
You're all clear, kid. Now let's blow this thing and go home.
Stand by.
Now, sit back and get ready to experience George Lucas's definitive vision with the first installment of the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition. In 1977, producer-director George Lucas created the Star Wars trilogy and changed the way we looked at movies. Now, 20 years later, using new digital technology, Lucas and his creative teams at Lucasfilm, THX, Skywalker Sound, and Industrial Light and Magic have completely restored, enhanced, and added to these classic movies to create the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition. For the trilogy's second installment, The Empire Strikes Back, Lucas supervised the addition of brand new footage, as well as an enhanced look for many of the film's key scenes and locations.
Once I started to redo the first film, it became such a good experience that I said, well, gee, we should go back and finish the other two films too.
I'm not afraid.
You will be.
One of the problems I had is one of the sequences with the Wampa ice monster. The monster that was developed originally didn't work, so I had to jettison that monster. I had Phil Tippett create a little tiny hand puppet, which we were able to use in two shots. It was just a head. And we just did it at the last minute to stick it in. But the rest of the sequence was sort of cut around the monster, where you hear it, but you don't see it. And there's a certain creative way of doing that. I mean, you can do it where you don't see the monster. And some people would say that's more artistic than actually showing it. But in this particular case, I really wanted to see the monster. And I felt it would add more tension to the scene and make it more interesting. So we were able to do that. I was able to go back, create a better version of the monster, and shoot the scene and all the cutaways to the monster and add them into the scene, which I think makes that ice scene make more sense than it did before. The snow battle was a challenge when we did it because nobody had ever done blue screen matting on a white surface. You usually do it on dark surfaces.
Here we go then. Action!
We used optical technology, of course, to do all that compositing. And a telltale sign that something's been optically composited is a black line around it. And when you have a sequence that takes place in outer space against stars, it's easy to reach a point where those black lines don't show up. But when you have a sequence that takes place against snow in the daylight, every hint of that black matte line becomes very visible. And so the first time through doing the snow battle here 17 years ago, a lot of effort went into finding ways to minimize that black line. One of the ways was to not print all of the elements at their full opacity.
All right, I'm coming in.
Consequently, when you see the snow battle on film, you may notice that there's part of the scenery is visible through the cockpit. And it was a constant trade-off of how transparent can we make the cockpit? At what point is the black line more objectionable than the transparency? And so there was an opportunity to go back into those shots, use the computer technology, and eliminate all the transparency, but also not have any matte lines.
The other issue was going into Cloud City. Cloud City was a very difficult thing to design and create originally as a floating city in the clouds. Some of the mat work there wasn't very good. And when they built the set, it's very confined. It's a very small set. It doesn't look out onto anything. It's just, you get this, it's a very claustrophobic kind of set. And that always bothered me. I wanted to be more open, see more of the city. And so what we've done is we've added to the approach of the city, similar to what we did with Mos Eisley in Star Wars. I mean, there's many more shots coming up to the city. You get to see more of the city. You get to see more speeders and those sorts of things. And then at the same time, when they land and they start walking through the city, now they walk through and there's large windows, you can see out and see more of the city, and it opens it up and makes it much larger. Be able to pull back and see these grand visions of balconies and the city beyond and all that kind of stuff. To do that before was almost impossible. And now we can do it. We're doing it, you know, we have moving shots, we have all kinds of things that they just weren't able to do before. It just was not possible up until a few years ago.
My ally is the Force, and the powerful ally it is.
Now,
Sit back and get ready to experience George Lucas's definitive vision of The Empire Strikes Back, the second installment in the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition. In 1977, producer-director George Lucas created the Star Wars Trilogy and changed the way we looked at movies. Now, 20 years later, using new digital technology, Lucas and his creative teams at Lucasfilm, THX, Skywalker Sound, and Industrial Light & Magic have completely restored, enhanced, and added to these classic movies to create the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition. For the trilogy's third installment, Return of the Jedi, Lucas supervised the addition of an elaborate new musical sequence, as well as improvements for one of the film's key creatures and the inclusion of brand new footage and music for the film's ending.
In Jedi, we've made several changes. When they go out to the Sarlacc pit, before there was just a couple of tentacles, and there was kind of a funny mouth with a few spikes sticking out of it, but there wasn't anything alive about the whole thing. And so what we've managed to do is take and create a kind of a beak that comes out and attacks him, and more tentacles, and it just looks much more realistic and much more threatening, which I think helps that scene considerably. In the Jabba the Hutt scene, there was a little musical number which we never really had the time to shoot. When we were doing it, the production was running behind, everybody was racing. We managed to catch a couple of shots of the band, and we put a little bit of music in it, but it was meant originally to be a big musical number, which I thought would be funny in the middle of a Star Wars film. Also, some of the puppets that we used were very static in how they could move.
The state-of-the-art animatronics had only reached a certain level. Cy Snoodles couldn't really open her mouth, she couldn't lip-sync properly, her eyes didn't move. It was a very complex creature to develop. And I think this gave us the opportunity to actually open that up.
It's a matter of really sculpting the characters in the computer, similarly to how you would out of clay. In fact, the computer graphic characters, we approach them a lot the way you would approach an animated drawing character, but they really are much more like puppets. We constantly find that we run into the limitations that you would typically encounter in building a puppet. They won't bend right, or their mass isn't right, or they're just the kind of things that puppeteers have been fighting for years. So it's as if we build these puppets, but then we turn them over to traditional animators to create the performance. So it's kind of a hybrid.
We've added one new character that they didn't have the time to actually develop on the third film, a Yasm. And he acts as a counterpoint to Cy, and they have a little duet. And it's just a fun musical number.
I think it adds more of the atmosphere and the quality that I was looking for originally in the Jabba sequence.
George has changed the lengths in some of these films for the reissue because of his improved animatics and so on, and it required some changes in the music, mostly additions and subtractions of a small sort. The only thing I had to re-record for this new trilogy was a short ends finale for the third, The Return of the Jedi, the very end of the film, where George created a new scene of celebrating. And he had some ideas for new music there, and gave me a film without any sound, but with a tempo, with the Ewoks sort of dancing and reacting and reveling, in their success.
The digital technology frees you up, especially in a fantasy film like this, in ways that are basically overwhelming. I mean, you could think of things, you can write things, but it's very hard to make that literal and make it real. And digital technology is the thing that's going to allow that whole medium, which is science fiction and fantasy and film, to flourish. as it never has before.
Now, sit back and get ready to experience George Lucas's definitive vision of Return of the Jedi, the third installment in the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition.